Saraswati, welcome to the mock interview.
Thank you, sir.
Tell us, Saraswati, about yourself, your academic qualifications, your work experience after you did your BTech, and your main hobbies, very briefly.
Yes, sir. Sir, I'm Ashwati Jiji. I graduated with a Bachelor of Technology in Electronics and Communication Engineering. I studied in the College of Engineering, Munnar, post which I worked for Infosys Limited in Mangalore, Karnataka for 3 years. And after that, I quit to pursue my civil services. And so my hobbies are, I engage in sprinting, and I also do journaling as well as listening to certain productivity related books.
So Aswati, you are from Kerala.
Yes, sir.
You see, the entire country is awaiting the third wave.
Yes, sir.
Or dreading third wave. I'm not saying awaiting is not the right word. Preparing for the third wave. But it seems that Kerala, you know, is one of the states where the second wave is not ending. So,
yes,
tell me any specific reasons. I mean, Maharashtra and Kerala. So, I will restrict to Kerala. What is so special about Kerala that there is a continuous stream of COVID cases, and the number of active cases actually don't climb down? So, if you can analyze the reasons, what is so unique about the state that this is happening?
Definitely, sir. So the reasons that I can think of are, first is that the testing proportion in the state is high even today, because last month there was a survey conducted and nationally the average was one test being done for 30 people. But in Kerala, it is 1:4, the ratio. So secondly, the demographic attributes such as aging population and very high proportion of non-communicable diseases such as diabetes can also result in the higher number of cases. And so thirdly, the expatriate community is still coming into the state of Kerala, bringing the infection, or they have a high likelihood of being infected. So all of these are the reasons why the cases are not decreasing, sir.
Okay, so if you were the district magistrate of Idukki, although it is your home state, you may be the district magistrate of Thiruvananthapuram. Now, with these three things that you have mentioned, the factors,
yes,
and you have all the powers, how would you either slow down or bring down the second wave or prevent third wave in your state, in your district particularly? What actions would you take from now onwards?
Yes, sir. So we need to take multiple steps. First would be to ensure that with the available number of vaccines and with least wastage, the population is vaccinated. So secondly, in order to check the inflow of infection from the expatriate community, we have to ensure that they are quarantined after they are coming into the state post the COVID tests. So thirdly, In the district of Idukki or Thiruvananthapuram, for any district if we take, Kerala has a very strong network of self-help groups and Anganwadi workers whom we can spring into action in order to do door-to-door campaigning. So with all these, I believe, sir, we can check the third wave to a significant extent.
So what are the deficiencies that you found in the second wave, actual handling of second wave? One is that the onset is high, the incidence is more, it is not slowing down. But unlike like what happened in Delhi,
yes,
what are the deficiencies that were seen in Kerala or are being seen now with regard to handling of the COVID second wave?
Yes, sir. So the deficiencies, we can say that the deficiencies primarily have arisen because of the there are lockdowns, and then so for example, the neighboring state of Tamil Nadu had taken complete lockdown, whereas in state of Kerala, it was only micro containment zones, and there were no complete lockdowns, because of which the shops were kept open and people were roaming outside, breaking the law. So that could be one of the reasons for high spread. And secondly, sir, even the people who were prescribed to be quarantined post the coming into the state from different countries, they also violated the laws to a significant extent. So maybe the climate also, for example, the onset of monsoon, and it's a very congenial condition for the virus to breed in the state, sir.
Okay. Aswati, I shift to another subject. You are electronics and communication engineer.
Yes, sir.
Now, can you just very briefly, narrate the communication revolution that India has seen over the last, say, 3 decades?
Yes, sir. So if we take the last 3 decades into consideration, first of all, we had in the communication arena, we began with 1G communication in the mobile phone communication. And now we gradually progressed to 2G second generation. And now we are planning to roll out the fifth generation of mobile phone communication. The second important change was with regard to the satellite communication. So it was in the 1980s that we began a program of the Indian remote sensing satellite systems and Indian satellite systems. So with these, presently we are one among the countries which have robust satellite communication technology available, and we have our regional positioning system, the IRNSS or the NAVIC. So these are the technologies that I see, sir, the changes. So
where does India stand in ICT and communication technology and the spread vis-a-vis other developed countries?
Yes, sir. So in the case of the spread of the communication and the communication technology, out of the 130 crore population, we have nearly 700 million users of mobile smartphones, and the telephone density is very high in urban areas, which is greater than 97%. In the rural areas too, there is higher density, but if we take the internet penetration, it's lagging, and it's only 18% compared to the rest of the country's 55%, sir.
Okay. Aswati, you have heard of Belt and Road Initiative of China, BRI?
Yes, yes, sir.
So what is the latest on the BRI, and how do you see it as whether it's a success or a failure, and how is India impacted with the BRI initiative?
Yes. So with regard to the recent developments in the Belt and Road Initiative, I see two aspects. One was that a European country like Italy had joined the BRI, and now it has come out in open and stated that it is a debt trap diplomacy by China. So secondly, we see in Sri Lanka, the Chinese companies have taken the lease, or have taken 99-year lease of Hambantota port, which is also a part of the Belt and Road Initiative. So with regard to the implications on our country, so we had always expressed our dissatisfaction with the Chinese debt trap diplomacy, and it is proving true, because most of the countries in the Indo-China Peninsula has also raised flags regarding their debts. So secondly, we have the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, which passes through our Jammu and Kashmir. So we are on high alert presently, sir.
So Aswati, now I pass on to Mr. Khanna for the next set of questions.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Khanna, please.
Good morning, Ashwati.
Good morning, sir.
Ashwati, what is your connection with Kanpur? I find that Kanpur also finds a mention in your death. You were born in Kanpur?
Yes, sir. So my father worked in the Indian Air Force for 30 years. So when he was posted in Kanpur, I was born, sir.
All right. So after that, you have visited Kanpur or Lucknow or Uttar Pradesh, any place?
Yes, sir. After the time of my birth, again, my father got reposted to Kanpur when I was studying in 11th standard. So I did my 11th and 12th from Kendra Vidyalaya Chakeri, Kanpur, sir.
Okay, okay. So to begin with, let us talk about Kanpur.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so why Kanpur at one time was known as Manchester of East?
Yes, sir.
And what has gone wrong? Why Kanpur remained stagnant with many other cities prospered, even though it was an industrial town?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. During the colonial times, Kanpur emerged as an industrial powerhouse, sir, with the large number of cotton textile industries present there. So, but post-independence, we saw that the state faced acute power shortages, due to which the industry could not sustain as one reason. So secondly, we saw cotton textile industries getting dispersed all over the country, whether it be the southern parts of the country, such as Karnataka or Tamil Nadu. They developed their power capabilities, and cotton does not lose weight while transportation. So the industries developed in multiple areas, and this reduced the prosperity of the cotton industries in Kanpur, sir.
And reasons for Kanpur remaining stagnant? What happened? Why Kanpur was not able to progress and develop?
Yes, sir. So one reason was that because other states developed, they provided cheap electricity and labor in surplus. So the production was better, or cost of production was lower in rest of the parts. So secondly, the labor also shifted out of Kanpur to their native states because the industries developed in those states. And so thirdly, it might also be a result of the problems with the governance. These are the reasons that I can see, sir.
All right. I see that coca farming.
Yes.
In your own farm, you experimented with coca farming.
Yes.
So how was that experience? Just tell us very quickly about coca farming and what you gained out of this experience.
Surely, sir. So I engaged in coca farming when I was at my home preparing for the civil services post quitting my job. So first I engaged out of curiosity. However, later I realized that the farmers of cocoa plantation faces a lot of problems. So with regard to cocoa farming, we import nearly 57% of our cocoa demands from other countries, particularly African countries. So secondly, it has not yet grown to be a plantation sector. It is still practiced as an intercrop system. And so thirdly, the cocoa farming is highly confined to the four states of southern India, such as the Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, and Andhra Pradesh. So the gain, what I gained out of this knowledge was, helped me understand the various challenges that the farmers undergo, particularly the cocoa farmers. First is that, so the crop is highly dependent upon monsoon for irrigation. So even a slight change in monsoon will result in significant drop in yield. So secondly, the price keeps fluctuating. And so thirdly, there is no organized body, at least in the state of Kerala, for procurement of these produce. So the middlemen exploit the farmers beyond the words.
Okay. Tell me about startup movement in Kerala. And do you have unicorns in startup, especially emerged in Kerala?
So the startup movement in Kerala has been given very high priority, and the state government encourages the formation of startups. So for example, there was, I'm unable to recall the name of the group right now, but instead of Zoom meeting, which is considered to be a foreign platform, from the Alappuzha district, there has been an initiative developed. So secondly, with respect to women entrepreneurship and startups, there is a special cell that the government has initiated. And so thirdly, with regard to the regulations, most of the approvals have been digitized. So, so with respect to the unicorns, so I will have to read about it.
Okay, okay, no problem. Can you tell me something about Silent Valley National Park of Kerala? It is God's own country. So this is one of the well-known national parks. So what are the salient features of this national park? Flora, fauna, whatever you can recall, quickly.
Sure, sir. The Silent Valley National Park is located in the district of Palakkad. The main river that flows through this is Kundipura. It is called Silent Valley because the an organism called Cycadus, which makes a loud noise at the evening, is absent in these, this national park. So Silent Valley is also a part of the Nilagiri Biosphere Reserve. And so this was the venue, this was one of the, there is an environmental movement, the Silent Valley National Park movement, which was initiated in 1980s to prevent a hydroelectric power station on the river to protect its biodiversity.
All right, Aswati, coming to telecom sector.
Yes, sir.
Can you tell me the business model which these telecom companies have evolved to protect the environment? And also, that is, you know, there is a particular thing whereby they all are joining hands with respect to towers. So what is this model? And number two is, should BSNL continue in the government sector?
So with respect to the environmental friendly initiatives that the telecom sector companies have taken, so one is that they have, most of the companies have switched to optical fiber mode of communication. So they lay underground cables, which will not impact the biodiversity of a region or which will not harm the animals on the ground. So secondly, the tower sharing is one of the steps that they have taken because the companies erect their antennas on a single tower or the base station. So with respect to the answer, there is also a universal service obligation fund which has been constituted into which all these companies contribute to develop telecom infrastructure in the rural areas. So with respect to the question whether BSNL must continue in the public domain, sir, I would want it to continue in the public domain. So because it has strategic importance when we see our definite some specific requirements such as ensuring that the rural area is connected, because the telecom companies which are private will work for profit in motives and they may not extend their service to those areas. So however, there must be improved governance structure installed in these BSNL. We can also go for corporate governance structures in BSNL, sir.
And Aswati, last question is, with so much of experience in Infosys, teaching, your own coca farming, why you want to be a part of government? Why do you want to become a civil servant?
Yes, sir. So my father worked for the Indian Air Force. So it had always been an inspiration for me to be a part of the government. So secondly, I see the work that is done by civil servants as very inspirational. The role that they play in the implementation of the welfare schemes for the vulnerable sections. And so thirdly, I also look forward to the job satisfaction that I would draw from this pursuit. So all of this motivates me to take up civil service as my career, sir.
Okay, thank you. Over to you, Mr. Sumesh.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay, good morning, Ashwin.
Good morning, sir.
So let's talk about your optional subject, geography.
Yes, sir.
So tell me, as a student of geography, which socioeconomic problems can be solved with the knowledge of geography?
Yes, sir. So the first and foremost, with the knowledge of geography, we can ensure that the crops that are cultivated in an area is in accordance with the agroclimatic zonation of our country. So this will result in reduced usage of resources such as water and higher yield of the crops, which will lead to prosperity of the farmers and address poverty. The secondly, the knowledge of geography helps one to be aware of the disasters that the area will witness. For example, in the eastern part of our country, cyclones are very prone. So we can take mitigative efforts and reduce the impact on life and property, sir.
Okay. So next question again on geography.
Yes,
sir. Digital geography only. What is the theory behind naming of cyclone? And why do we see more cyclones in the east coast rather than the west coast?
Yes. So we started naming of cyclones in 2000. So it is in order to ensure that there are multiple factors behind naming. First is to ensure that the communication about a cyclone is rendered very correctly. So for example, we see cyclones happening simultaneously in our country. Last year, we witnessed the cyclone Yaas and cyclone Amphan. So whenever these occur together, in order to deliver the information very correctly, we need naming. So secondly, it is a method for proper maintenance of records about what was the destruction, which areas were getting affected, all those. So with regard to second question is why East Coast is being affected. The first reason is that in the Bay of Bengal, the sea surface temperature tends to be higher because it's being encircled by continent, the landmass, and it gets heated up very soon. This is one of the conditions for the development of cyclone. Secondly, we see the cyclones, the typhoons and the cyclones driven from the South China Sea towards the east coast of our country by the trade winds or the southwest trade winds. Thirdly, the salinity of the Bay of Bengal is lesser because of the draining of Godavari and Krishna rivers, which makes it highly sensitive to temperature. Because of these reasons, we see very frequent cyclones in the east, sir.
So let's move on to economy.
Yes, sir.
What steps should the central bank take to control inflation?
Yes, sir. So in order to control inflation, the central bank can take steps, multiple steps. First is to reduce the money in circulation. We can do this, it can be done by increasing the cash reserve ratio, the statutory.
In the context of present situation.
Oh, okay, sir. Okay, sir. So in the context of present situation, the inflation is mainly because of the cost push factor. Here, we see very high prices of fuel, pulses, oil seeds, and even the agricultural products. So these are driving the inflation, where the central bank might not have much of control, because we are witnessing us particular scenario where we have pandemic on the one hand and inflation on the other hand. So if at all the RBI tries to control the money supply, it will affect the growth prospects of the country, sir. Because the small and medium scale industries require money at present. So it cannot hide the interest. It will be through fiscal policy. Yes, sir.
What is the way out?
So in order to control the inflation at present, the government must step in. So both the center and the state, there have been proposals from multiple states to bring the fuel under GST so that we can reduce its the demand. So secondly, we must diversify the areas from where which we bring oil seeds and pulses. And in the future, we must increase their cultivation so that we reduce the import cost on these commodities. So in these ways, I think we can manage the inflation, sir.
If you wish, you can have a glass of water.
It's okay, sir.
It's okay. Okay, one more question on economy. In your opinion, when do you think India is going to achieve its target of 5 trillion economy?
So, had the pandemic not struck, we might have achieved the 5 trillion economy by 2025. So, I would say that in the present context, we might achieve it by 2028 or 29, because before achieving it, we need a sustained growth of 10 to 12% per annum. And the World Bank have predicted that we will have an 8 to 9% growth in the coming years after the pandemic. And so secondly, we see capital infrastructure projects from the part of the government, such as the National Infrastructure Pipeline, and multiple initiatives by the state also. So with these, we will probably achieve it by 2028 or 7.
Pass on to chairman.
So Aswati, we had elections in Kerala some time ago.
Yes, sir.
Now, Kerala has many people who are overseas, residing overseas, and they are not able to take part in voting.
Yes, sir.
Now, one suggestion to involve the NRIs and even the local voters who are not on the on their station, on their headquarters on the poll day, is to consider or explore the possibility of having internet voting.
Yes.
Now, you are a electronics engineer. What are your views? Can India enter into a interneting voting era, number one? And number two, looking at the complexities of elections and requirements, should one resort to internet voting?
Yes, sir. So when we began our election, we started with paper ballots, and later when we progressed to electronic voting system, and the latest development is voter verifier or audit trials. So definitely, sir, a move into internet voting is possible. So, but considering the present threat to our cyber security, for instance, we were attacked, even our critical infrastructure such as the Kudankulam nuclear power plant or the electricity grid in Mumbai was attacked. So before switching it completely, on a pilot basis, we can try. But so with improvement in technology, and we see new technologies such as blockchain coming into picture. With these, we can ensure secure voting. And so maybe within a decade, we will definitely transition into internet voting, sir.
That is, you have told me the first point that we are capable of doing it.
Yes, sir.
But should India go for internet voting at all, even if we are capable? How would you ensure the secrecy of vote in internet voting?
Yes, sir. So in order to ensure the secrecy of voting, we have technologies being suggested, such as blockchain, where once we input a value, we cannot change it.
No, you are seeing the change at the later end, once
yes,
a person has voted.
Yes, sir.
But while voting, he can be in the public view.
Yes, sir.
While he votes. He votes at home. All his family members are watching him, influencing him. What about the secrecy? Why do you go into a polling booth and then finally to a voter's compartment alone?
Okay, sir.
Can you ensure this in internet voting?
So the for internet voting, yes, sir, I agree that there might be external influences and it might affect one's thought process while voting. So, sir, rather than completely switching into internet voting, we can maintain a hybrid system. And whether our country needs it or not, so in the present condition also, we see that, as you have already mentioned, that we have nearly 30 million people residing outside our country who are unable to vote. And more than that, we have the migrant laborers in our country who are always on the move and they are unable to cast their votes. So if we ensure an electronic voting pattern, we can improve participation of the citizens in this process, sir. However, it will have multiple threats and we need much more secure systems.
So Aswati, we have asked you quite a few questions covering many areas.
Yes,
sir. If you think that we have missed out any area and we should ask you another question from that missed out area or any subject of your choice, I can ask you the last question.
Yes, sir.
Tell me
Yes, sir. So with regard to my hobbies,
some hobby and let me know, then I will try to ask the question from there.
Yes, sir. So listening to audiobooks on productivity.
Listening to audiobooks?
Yes, sir. Right. On productivity.
Okay. So tell me, how is listening to audiobooks better for sustainable reading compared to either a textbook reading or watching an audio visual? Yes. Have you understood?
Yes, sir. So the listening to audiobooks has multiple advantages in comparison to visuals and reading. First is that when we listen, it helps us to imagine. And secondly, it improves our comprehension as well as vocabulary skills. And so thirdly, it is an efficient utilization of the technological advancement. So which results in saving the time, which is a precious commodity for everyone, sir.
So Aswati, we finish our formal interview now.
Aswati, this is going to be your first interview in UPSC?
No, sir. Last year was my first interview.
Last year. So how much did you score last year?
So 157.
And today, how do you rate your performance vis-a-vis what transpired last year?
So last year, I was not prepared and not confident. So this time I feel I'm better prepared.
Okay. And any areas of deficiency according to you, where you think you missed out? Because it is important. If you know, it helps me in explaining to you.
Sir, one of the questions related to startup. So I must read about the policies that the state has taken. So that would be one area, sir.
So, Aswati, you have good personality. You are confident. You were smiling while replying. And even knowledge was reasonably okay. Why I'm using the term reasonably? Because
yes, sir,
in some of the questions, the depth of you know, what we were expecting, little
yes,
more deeper insight into the issues, that was not coming out.
Okay, sir.
So I'll give you an example. Kanpur,
yes,
why Kanpur has not progressed over a period of time.
Yes, sir.
You stopped at the point where industries and labor fled from Kanpur.
Yes, sir.
But then there were many more factors. So then I have to remind you that second part. So
okay,
that is number one. listen to the question and address all the issues. Silent Valley National Park.
Yes, sir.
Since geography is your subject, I had asked this question with intention of getting a reply whereby you will give me little more insight into the flora and fauna of National Park and its geography.
Okay, sir.
So here also you gave me a reply.
Yes, sir.
I know that you were aware, but you didn't go deeper into it. Coca farming was good because that is something you were personally involved and you gave, right up to the impact on farmers and how it was affecting their life. But startup movement in Kerala and unicorns in Kerala.
Yes, sir.
Because the moment you talk of coca farming.
Yes, sir.
Or jackfruit farming or things like that, the startups will definitely emerge.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so okay, startup sir. Movement in Kerala, please look into the unicorns.
Yes,
and how much this movement has started.
Okay, sir.
So what I am saying is depth of your replies.
Yes.
And last but not the least is business model of telecom sector.
Yes, sir.
Where they are protecting environment and why BSNL should or should not be privatized. You are a ICT graduate.
Yes, sir.
And you had to give a reply after I clarified that, you see, sharing of tower is a very big business model.
Yes, sir.
So how much cost capital they have saved?
Yes, sir.
Business model comprises of two things. How much cost saving is there? And number two, impact on the environment.
Okay, sir.
All right. So
yes,
give me the reply that I was expecting was a technical reply from you.
Yes, sir.
That let's say 40% is what they estimate as the capital cost that was saved. Otherwise, telecom would have been so expensive.
Mm-hmm.
And today it is one of the cheapest in India.
Okay.
So go into telecom business model and BSNL, there are many more reasons. It is government wants to keep it as a strategic partner.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so there you did give a good reply on why. So my overall assessment is, you have everything in you, good personality, good understanding, good knowledge. Add depth to the reply. Listen to the question. And you yourself will know where you are missing out the point. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Over to you, Vinodji.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
So, Aswati, I totally endorse what Khanna Saab has mentioned. I will mention a few more things, but then even for sake of repetition, I must tell you your good points. You see, you were capable of taking all the questions. It is not that you were stuck somewhere or you were not able to, or maybe you had to say, sorry, sir, I'm not aware. Now that is a good point.
Yes.
Which means that your span of knowledge, little about many things.
Yes.
But when we put a question to you,
yes,
and then you had to answer them, you could cover the answer very partially.
Okay, sir.
When in addition to the depth point which Khanna Saab has mentioned,
yes,
I would also add one more thing, that your answers were partial, they were not complete. I will give some instances.
Yes.
So that is point one.
Yes.
So I will point out those things where you need to improve.
Yes.
And you are capable of improving. It's not,
yes,
see, the simplest, if the review or if the feedback is that you need to study more, you need to acquire more knowledge, you want to need to read more, I think you should be the happiest person in that case.
Yes,
because you cannot change your personality in a week or 10 days.
Yes.
Right?
Yes, sir.
So, but you can always acquire knowledge in even 1 hour.
Yes, sir.
So from that angle, you stand a very good chance to score well.
Yes.
Because overall personality, you are able to answer. You are good in communication. And since you were trying to, you know, you were making efforts to search the answer.
Okay, sir.
And one can could see from the expression, we may be wrong.
Yes.
But you were trying to search, and that is why you were not as fluent.
Okay, sir.
As you could be. You have no problem of English. I think people from Kerala like you, I mean, they speak the best English, most fluent.
Okay, sir.
But you were slightly slow, not that you should be fast.
Yes, sir.
But the expression that you gave was that you are searching the answer and looking for validation, whether I've told the right thing or not, whether I've told the right thing or not. And then you could cover only partially. So all this revolves around only one thing.
Yes.
That you need to go deeper into every aspects, every issue that could be a possible question in the main interview.
Okay, sir.
Now, the question then comes, how do I deepen my knowledge? So knowledge, whatever are the DAF areas, you need to pick up and, you know, identify, jot down all the emerging questions which may come out of your DAF entries.
Okay, sir.
For example, your Kerala is a very big source of questions.
Yes.
I need not mention all things that can be, you know, you could be asked about God's own country. You could be asked about sustainability, you know, achievements, because Kerala has achieved so many things. Kerala has been first in literacy. Kerala has been, you know, first in many things.
Yes.
They are rather the torchbearers and leaders in all aspects. So there can be multiple questions from Kerala.
Yes, sir.
Then you are an electronics and communications engineer. So that is a big area today. Digital India could take all kinds of questions.
Yes, sir.
So you must, Aswati, go through everything on earth which is possible related to your death. Because in communications, if you see our questions, I asked you about Kerala. I asked you about communication because you're an engineer. And of course, I asked you about Belt and Road Initiative because current affairs today itself, the External Affairs Minister has made a statement on BRI and has mentioned that connectivity is a matter of trust.
Trust, yes.
So I took out Belt and Road Initiative primarily because it may be fresh in your mind, because if you have read today's newspaper, you would have read that as well. So you try to understand all the questions were related to something which is happening around.
Yes.
You know, we did not pick up something which is age old, 20, 30 years. Yes. I was expecting in the, you know, now coming to the partial answers.
Yes.
Let me just give example. Now, I asked you about the communication revolution in the last 3 decades.
Yes, sir.
So, Aswati, you have to go back to the 90s.
Yes, sir.
You started with 1G, 2G, 3G, and you just finished with that.
Okay, sir.
We are not talking of communication revolution in India. You have to go back where India was 30 years ago.
Okay,
30
sir.
Years ago, India was in a state when telephone connections you could not get.
Yes, sir.
You had to bribe people, you know, and maybe make recommendation to get a telephone connection.
Yes.
What to talk of mobile.
Mm.
You had yes. to book trunk calls by going to post offices and other places.
Okay,
you had to do lightning calls if you wanted to talk immediately. Then came the STD. STD okay, itself was a revolution in mid-90s. Then came late 90s mobiles.
Yes,
and
sir.
Those were very crude mobiles. And then you have the mobile revolution which started. Then you have smartphones. So, Swati, you should have started like this.
Okay.
You know, you yes. straight away came to, you know, in the 21st century, straight away 1G, 2G, 3G. And especially when I had mentioned 3 decades.
Yes, sir.
you know, at the beginning of the first decade, if you say, there was no mobile phone in India. So one was expecting how India has moved from a time when there was no telephone connections.
Yes, sir.
To one of the second largest mobile set owners, right, after China.
Yes, sir. Yes.
This is the revolution. That's why I use the word revolution.
Okay.
So that's why I said your answer was partial. I asked you about you being Kerala DM, you know, in your district. Now, the expression that you used was, we should do this, we should do that. Now, you see, when a question is placed before you in that format, just irrespective of the content, see, this is a personality test.
Okay, sir.
Not just the knowledge test. So, when you have been mentioned that you are the district magistrate of Thiruvananthapuram.
Yes, sir.
And you have to sort of do this, what would you do? Your format, your should be in that particular I format. Sir, as district magistrate, I will do this, I will do this, I will do that. Now, okay. The moment you say we should do this, the government should do that, you know, the first impression that goes is that you are a risk averter.
Okay.
You are not ready to own the responsibility.
Okay.
You should be very assertive. Sir, I would do this. I would, you know, have a coordination with the medical staff, the police, this, that, whatever. Use that I format, you know, but don't lose that.
Okay, sir.
That is number two. Your BRI was good. Belt and Road Initiative, that was a good answer, debt trap and all. Quality-wise, you know, whatever partial answers you gave, they were very good.
Okay.
But one required something more than that. Your answers were also structured, I would say. I like the way you were mentioning, firstly, secondly, thirdly, fourthly. Right? But the format of structuring, you know, it's always good when you say firstly, secondly, because you're not vague, you're not weird. But you should have some content also.
Yes.
And lastly, in internet voting also I realized that your answer was very partial. You straight away thought about the cyber security, that is the only thing that came to your mind.
Yes.
Then you brought about the blockchain technology. Now, anything which has not been tested, I mean, I was only referring to internet voting means online voting.
Okay, sir.
There was no question of any technology. So how robust we are, you mentioned it. We are still not, you know, robust enough. Number two, even Kerala may not be 100% internet covered, right?
Yes.
The Gulf may not be internet covered. So yes. How does you talk about digital divide within India. So how would people have an access to the internet? Now, these are some basic things. Yes. You have to think as an administrator.
Okay, sir.
And finally, the secrecy of vote. Well, you have to think how election will change.
Yes, sir.
Will you go to an internet kiosk? So setting up internet kiosk is as good as setting up a polling station.
Yes,
sir. Right?
Yes.
So these are some of the observations which I had. So in all, I think you must, finally, what I mean to say is, as Khanna Sahib has mentioned, you have to read, you have to study more, you have
yes.
to deepen your knowledge.
Yes,
and that is it. Nothing more. Everything else will be taken care of. Any questions you have from us, Saswati, now?
No, sir.
Nothing? So today we have considered, Saswati, you for... Rated you as 60%.
Okay, sir.
Right. So it is certainly better than what you may have done in your actual interviews. But you are a material who should certainly get between 65% to 70%. Only if you increase your knowledge.
Okay, sir. Yes.
So all the best to you.
Thank you, sir.
All the best.
Thank you.
All the best, Ashwati.
Yes, sir.